Welcome to Bod's Mayhem Hour, your source for all hard rock, heavy metal, new metal, alternative, punk, horror punk, hardcore,
rock,
and all local bands with your host, John the Bod, a.k.a. the Bodfather.
This is Eddie Solis from It's Casual, and you're listening to Bod's Mayhem Hour.
The views and opinions of the guests do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of Bod's Mayhem Radio Network, its staff, affiliates, or sponsors. Parental discretion is advised. Welcome to Bod's Mayhem Radio Network.
Hey everybody, welcome to Bod's Mayhem Hour. I'm your host, John the Bod, a.k.a. the Bod Father. And as always, I bring you guys awesome interviews. I have a new co-host that's on here with me. Her name is, and I'm going to let her introduce herself before we get to our awesome, awesome interview here. So, who do we have here with us?
Hey, guys, it's Brittany.
So, I have a new co-host named Brittany Charles. She's going to be on here from time to time with us. And good way to break her in. We just had CJ Ramon earlier, and then now we're going to be interviewing a good friend of mine. He's from out in Los Angeles, California, Mr. Eddie Solis from It's Casual. He has a new CD that's getting ready to process out here, I think, next month. They're going to do a listening party for the new Los Angeles 2. So, Eddie, my man, what's going on?
Hey, John, how are you? And hello to your co-host as well. Welcome.
Ah, man, you're always welcome on here, and it's good to have you back on here. So, let's get to talking about the new Los Angeles 2. So what's up with this one?
Oh, man, I'm excited. This is the fourth studio record, and it's a heavy hitter. Basically, coming up with the new Los Angeles 1, it's been a really good 2 years of press coming and live shows, you know, Fu Manchu, Mastodon, Prong, bands like that. And, we're ready to do a new music video with Rick Kosick, who is known for his work on Jackass, the TV show on MTV, and the theatrical movie as well. He did the Redline video, and now we're going to be working on something called The Gold Line. That's the first single off the new Los Angeles 2. Mm-hmm. So we'll be shooting that video soon, and it's going to have Rick's magic touch on it. So we're really looking forward to that.
So what about the playing some of these songs live? How are the fans reacting to them?
You know what's great is the headlining shows we've been doing across the country. We've been doing a headlining set now, usually. And when we do a set, we play the new LA 1 in its entirety and then 2. And the cool thing is both releases are extremely cohesive. So it just sounds like a natural progression. And live, we open up with the new Los Angeles 1, the whole album, and we do part 2. And so it's really... it's kind of a physical challenge because it's just so much riffing and like just screaming, simultaneously on my end. You know, I'm the singer and guitarist. I'm the bassist, basically, because we're a two-piece. And so it's really like I just got to have my precision down on my fingering and my tones completely dialed in and the endurance to keep the intensity of the vocals up. So it's good. It's I call it, it's conditioning. It's like a sport now. It's not even a band no more.
Got to do your warm-ups.
We have to, man. We have to. But I think the warm-ups is loading in all the big cabinets and all the walls of amps. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's good. That's good. I mean, it's just two of us, so I'm doing a lot of lifting.
We'll put Brittany to work and let her load all your cabinets and stuff on the stage. How about we do that?
Yeah. When we go through your hometown, you could definitely help us out.
That would
be appreciated.
That'd be for sure.
What's some of your favorite tracks off this album?
Personally, I love the opener called The Gold Line. When I wrote it, I had a very conscious decision to give a nod to one of my favorite guitarists, Greg Ginn, for Black Flag. And so the riff is, I want to say it has a lot of flagism in it. And it's heavy, but like super, like very, very moody and just so balls to the wall crushing. And there's a lot of good fingering in the riffs, but it's not like crammed. It has a lot of breathing room and a lot of soul, so there's like a heartbeat behind it. And so playing that is great. And the second track, Less Violence, More Violin, love playing that. Because it's a lot of guitar work, not too many vocals. So I'm actually stepping back and playing. And then we have an instrumental called The Gap is Widening, which is like It's recorded at 7.5 minutes long, but when you play it live, it's about 11 minutes.
Good God.
It's like our Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner from Iron Maiden.
Wow. And you know what? I mean?
It's a lot of parts. Good.
You don't see a lot of bands putting that much time in a song anymore. You don't have the guitar solos, and you don't have the breakdowns and stuff like you used to for a 7 and 8 minute song.
That's true. That's true. So the song, The Gap Is Widening, it's very, like, I want to say it's very hard rock grooving, very, like, Black Flag, Soundgarden, Meat Puppets kind of work. But the thing is the end of it is very free. It's very free jazz-oriented, and it allows my drummer and myself to demonstrate our musical chops with a lot of riffs and a lot of odd time signatures that are pretty challenging. And I would say, for the most part, would be considered, quote-unquote, you know, as far as musical ability, above average, as far as, you know, playing those time signatures accurately. So it gives us a chance to show another dimension of our ability as musicians, and gives us another dimension as far as what kind of player we are. And it's not really in a progressive metal way. It's very jammy. It's very not only jammy, but kind of harsh and very moody. And I would say, you know, I mean, some of the time signatures are like in 5/7, so it has like an Apple feel to it on some of it.
I've got to listen to this, and I really like it. I love the heaviness that you guys bring to this, especially, like, you know, the Gasoline, when that first kicks off, man. And then you get, you know, you get Wick, and then you got Live Food. I mean, this whole album's good. You know, there's
thank you. I mean, as a fan of music, like, how would you categorize?
As a fan of music, I consider this a heavy metal CD. I mean, you know, it's
heavy, right?
Yeah, it's heavy. It's on the punk side, right? You know, it's on the punk hardcore side, kind of. I mean, it's got everything into one if you like the heavy side. And for me, this does it for me. What about you, Brittany?
I love heavy.
So, yeah, I mean, you know, you got kudos from us, man.
Thank you. Thank you. That's always good.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Hey,
heavier
so,
the better.
One thing I wanted to bring to light was that, you know, Rick Kostick from Jackass, you know, it's really exciting to work with him, because growing up in the 90s, skateboarding, I would read this magazine called Big Brother. I don't know if you ever heard of it. Have you ever heard of that magazine?
No, I haven't, actually.
Yeah, it was like, you know, there was Thrasher magazine, there was Power Edge, Transworld, and Big Brother. Big Brother was like a naughty magazine. It was owned by Larry Flint. And
okay.
They would have, like, these, you know, interesting ads for skate companies and Big Brother themselves that were kind of, at the time, I guess they were considered kind of like edgy and sexual, because they would have models like in the ads for skateboard magazines,
yeah,
or skateboard manufacturers. So they would get a lot of hate mail, right?
Oh, yeah.
But that's where they got a lot of attention, because they were doing something that was considered, you know, inappropriate. I would buy that magazine, and I would get all the magazines. And I would, you know, I just have like this vision of going back to that day, or those days when I had a mini ramp, and I would look at Rick Kostick's photos, because he was a photo editor. And I just remember looking at his epic photos he would take with, like, all these, you know, professional skateboarders, and I get so inspired. So to be working with him on my second music video, actually it's our third, because he did the Red Line video, which was the first single off the New Los Angeles record.
Yeah.
And that went viral and got us a lot of attention from, like, NPR and Huffington Post and, you know, LA Times and all these great media outlets, you know. And he did this other video for our other song, Skate or Die. He put it in a video called Skateboarding with Wee-Man. You know who Wee-Man is, right?
Yeah, yeah, I know who Wee-Man
is.
Yeah,
yeah, and that's awesome, because that video is his number one video on his YouTube channel, and it's like over 304,000 views right now. That's really
cool, awesome.
Because, you know, that's a lot of views on the video, and that's a lot of ears on our music. So the track he put from his Casual is a track called Skate or Die, which is the third track on the Los Angeles one, which is our third record. So, you know, all that, you know, I'm mentioning all this because we're going to be working together again on the Goal Line video, which is the first single for the New Los Angeles 2, and we're just excited because he's got the same crew involved, and we're going to do things, you know, just make it funner and even more exciting. So it's going to be a lot of energy and work we're going to put into it.
So, Eddie, man, working on this new album, did you hope you was bringing something a little bit different than what's out there today as far as heavy music?
It's true. It's true. That is the truth for me. You know, for me, as a fan of music, I mean, I'm always going to shows, I'm always buying records, and I'm always enthusiastic reading about bands.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as much as I'm an active player, I'm an active fan as well. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so when I put this record together, you know, the New Los Angeles 2, I was extremely conscious and had a coherent vision, you know, saying, hey, I could definitely go by the same gear that most bands have to get a certain sound and install a look into the band. But you know what? After 10 years and 4 records and, you know, 4 different tours, it's like, it's a thing where you have to take ownership of your individuality and go with what you do best. And I think as far as, you know, hardcore, you know, metal, hardcore duos, I know for a fact there's not many people sounding like we are, and that's not to say that what we do is superior. It's about, to me, it's about just being honest to yourself. If you could honestly express yourself, I think that's like the most priceless thing. And I could tell you that I'm honestly expressing myself. So to document it, to release it, and to be able to, you know, open, you know, these publications and seeing, you know, my band in Thrasher magazine and my records distributed around the world, and to be able to talk to you, to me, if I'm doing all those things by honestly expressing myself, then mission accomplished.
Yeah, that's what I do this show for, is to get, you know, local talent out there like yourself. And I know you've been around for a while, but hey, what's a little bit more exposure to help you out, you know?
Oh, that's fantastic. I mean, you know, we've done a lot of great shows. We've, you know, done stuff with High on Fire, Mastodon, Story of the Year.
Wow.
A really big band. You know, you've been on Warped Tour. You know, we were asked to be the rhythm section for Revolution Mother, you know, and toured with CKY. So, you know, there's a strong foundation. I'm proud of it. And the best thing about it is I've never followed the trend. I've never pragmatically tried to mold myself to be something that I'm not. Everything is just a complete reflection of who I am. You know, the words, the music, the delivery live, it's just all honest.
What do you hope the fans take away from this album?
I want the fans to take away something positive, because I, without preaching like a straight edge or posy, you know, positive, posy core, you know, kind of message, I'd rather just pour all out on stage, speak lyrics of real life experiences, and basically I want the fans to get hit with like a bulldozer and be like, wow, you know what? These guys, two guys, and they just bring it so raw and so legit, and just from a pure place. I want to, you know, touch the people who are artists, whether they're painters, photographers, and hopefully the energy of this castle perpetuates them and inspires them to go do their art in the most purest form.
You got a lot of music out there, man, that does that. And like I said, I'm not saying it's just because you're on here, but it's just the truth. I like your freestyle of music range, and you stand behind your music, and you believe in what you say, too.
I just think, like, you know, it's about taking ownership of what you're putting out there.
Yeah.
And if you could stand behind it, then, you know, I think all of us are our own best advocate. You know, we can have people working for us, you know, making phone calls for us, or, you know, whatever it is. I just think we, no matter what industry you're in or what you're doing, you know, even if you're not in the spotlight in life, I think it's no matter what it is, we are all our own best advocate. And I think it's my responsibility to take complete ownership of my art and stand behind it.
What can fans expect at a show from you?
Well, you know what? One thing I do take a lot of pride in is that we're the first two-piece hardcore band from Los Angeles ever. And we were formed in 2002. You know, we just wrapped up our fifth record. The fourth one's coming out, but we just wrapped up our fifth. So we've been around 12 years, you know. And it's been a great run. It's been a lot of hard work, and it's been very pleasant and very exciting. And it's makes the unit stronger every day that goes by. So I think when people see us live, they see two guys on there, on the stage, that want to be there and to play better than the record. Meaning, it's going to be extremely loud, super heavy, because the type of two-piece we are is we don't have any loops, we don't have any pre-recorded stuff. I use a special pedal combination that allows the bass and guitar to go out simultaneously, which is pretty, it's the way I like what I feel about it, is it's a way to make it sound extremely explosive in the most organic way with no, like, have like extra homogenized, you know, pedals that are used as processors. Like, the sound is just straight through, you know, just organic loud distortion. So when you see it, it's like the record magnified times 10.
Yeah. So you're not going to hear any pre-recorded stuff. It's going to be all legit live.
No loops, no effects that are looping anything. Everything is natural. And so there was, you know, there's no bassist and two guitars. It's just me. So
yeah.
I need to be on top of it, because if I drop out, the whole thing drops out.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, exactly. Does it ever get old to hear the fans sing along to your music? And how does it make you feel?
It's priceless, because I've sat down in my room, you know, writing these songs over the years. And when I have, you know, people messaging me, say, asking for, like, certain types of set lists, you know, play this, play that, it's great. You know, it's that in itself is rewarding. And for me, playing the song every time, the song gets better.
What do you think your band brings to the table for music?
Well, that's a good question. I think what we bring is a way to play heavy music with a smile on your face.
Yeah.
Where like, it's like, look, I just got back from the skate park. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
And I got more gear than some dude that looks tough in a metal band, in a new metal band that's going to be gone 2 years from now, because he's onto something else. What that means is there's a lot of filler bands out there. There's so much in every genre, and it's so easy to play a role. You know what I mean? To look tough and act and be so you know, heavy. But, you know, it's like when you pick things apart and look at a band like Slayer, they're playing straight through a Marshall. There's not a lot of frills. These guys are great players and have great ears and know how to make things work. What I bring to the table of music, or the whole music platform, is the heaviness. I think the message is also what it's casual brings is showing people that the heaviness is not about what you're playing. It's either in you and in your hands, and you'll make anything sound heavy, because that's something you've experienced,
mm-hmm.
and you know how to let it resonate through an instrument.
Mm-hmm.
So it's how to answer your question is how to perpetuate a feeling through an instrument, no matter what the gear is, and like, you're going to feel the vibe. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, definitely. You know, man, you're in radio, I'm in radio. So do you think the digital age and social media has helped get your music out there a lot better than, say, years ago?
Yeah. I mean, it's really cool, because I have, like, you know, a lot of stores that buy as casual vinyl direct, mm-hmm. and I could just, you know, all these, you know, for that's one platform, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Definitely. And they'll like, ask for the records through email, and I'll send them play copies also, but they'll get it, and they'll distribute it to staff and to some of their customers on their email list. And then that will, in turn, warrant these customers to special order the vinyl, and then the stores order from me. And it's just an ongoing thing. There's a lot of independent stores throughout the country. Mm-hmm. So, you know, just direct to the customer, direct to retail, also circulating it, you know, your music, obviously sharing Spotify and Rhapsody and iTunes and Amazon on Facebook and Twitter, etc. Getting, you know, your music out there to social networking is pretty amazing. And I think, like, being in radio also, it just helps spread your message out much quicker.
Oh yeah.
It's amazing.
How much is writing a relief for you?
I'm the kind of guy that loves going hikes, go to the beach and relax and get in the water and do, you know, just do fun, mellow things like that, connect with the earth. So I think on the flip side, writing releases all the I don't want to say turmoil, but all the experiences of life, you know, and things that you come across, which aren't always what you hope for, but that's living. You know what I mean? So
right.
It's therapy for me, you know, like, I choose to express myself in a heavy way, you know, in the form of the music. That's the way I do it. So listening and, you know, to other music, I'm listening to all types of music. But to answer your question, writing is a huge release. It's my therapy. It clears me, you know, it clears my head. It brings clarity to me. And just makes me feel good.
Are you working on any new projects?
Well, you know, I have an AM talk radio show.
Yes. Los Angeles Vista, is that right?
Yeah, that's it. And it's cool because first time John and I talked, it was on the internet only.
Yeah.
And I was so happy to have, you know, that platform. Since then, it's been picked up on AM talk radio, and it's in three major markets: San Diego, Orange County, which is a part of LA, and Inland Empire.
That's awesome.
That's a huge area, all three of those markets. And then, you know, that's on 1510 AM KSPA in Orange County and Inland Empire, then 1450 AM in San Diego. But then obviously, you know, you could stream it worldwide. But to have that platform and have it in a prime time is pretty rewarding. And I think it's a testimony to just being committed to it.
Mm-hmm.
And being extremely passionate. You know, let me back up. Having a passion and being able to work the passion to its fullest, and then it translates into, like, you know, some good old-fashioned honest work, and people give you an opportunity, and it's all perfect timing, and it just works. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So, I know exactly what you mean.
For me, it's that's one project. The other project is my label, Stoke Records. I'm going to be releasing a lot of bands next year, 2015. That's what I've been working on. Like, the majority of my day goes to, you know, working on the label, Stoke Records, and the radio show. The radio show is on AM prime time on weekend here in Southern California. So on Saturdays, it's 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, and Sundays, 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. So that's pretty good time for weekends.
It's pretty good stuff, man. Congratulations on that, because I know you've been working hard at this. I know I work hard at this for sure. So, and
yeah, and coming from you, I'm really grateful to get your blessings, because if anyone knows how much work goes into it, it's you.
Oh yeah, Oh, I definitely know, and all the rejections and things like that. I mean, you just got to keep on going. I mean, keep beating those doors down, man. You know, it's gonna stop sooner or later.
Oh, yeah, exactly. I mean, I always say this, you know, persistence beats resistance.
Oh, yeah, that's exactly right. That's exactly right. Now,
you know,
correct me if I'm wrong, didn't you do a split with the band here recently, or am I incorrect on that? Because I thought I seen something on that.
Oh, yeah, we did two splits the past couple of years. The first one we did was a 7-inch vinyl release. One side was It's Casual, and the other side was Bullet Treatment. Bullet Treatment is a killer punk band from Southern California, LA, to be specific. And this guy, Chuck Dietrich, he's awesome. He's his band, and he has a revolving door. And one of the singers of Bullet Treatment is Matt from the Bronx. And, you know, Matt's got a great voice. The other split 7-inch that we did is with a band called Early Man. Yeah, and that's killer. Our track on the Early Man split 7-inch vinyl is called Suffering, and Billy Anderson, he actually produced that and recorded it. Billy Anderson is a great force. I mean, the guy's a studio force to be reckoned with. He's worked on Melvin's record, Neurosis, and Sleep, you know? And the guy, you know, he's just great at what he does. And we made a record with him called The Billy Anderson Sessions that hasn't seen a light of day yet. And that's the fifth record that's ready to come out. We're really excited about it, and so we took one of the tracks from that session and put it on the split 7-inch with Early Man.
When is the release show for the new Los Angeles 2?
Well, we're going to have on Street Gate, Tuesday, December 16th, we're going to have a listening party here in downtown Los Angeles at a great venue called Salvage. And so what we're also going to do is we're going to be doing a release show probably in the official release show will most likely be in January, because we want to do it right at a great club and with great bands. So, you know, the holidays sometimes, you know, it just gets in, you know, real life gets in the way, and that's fine. But what we're going to do is have a listening party and be there with all our friends and fans December 16th at Salvage. But the release show is to be determined.
What about touring? You got any scheduled shows coming up here shortly or anything?
Well, no shows right now. Right now, we just had a website go up. It's casualband.com, and that is being revamped as we speak. You know, the new record is coming out December 16th on CD, and the vinyl issue is going to be coming out on Record Store Day 2015, and that's going to be awesome. Double vinyl gatefold with, like, it's going to be 180-gram vinyl and two-colored vinyl with, like, really high-quality jacket, you know, like the stock paper of the jacket is going to be really thick and high quality.
Yeah, I saw those. I saw them. I saw you post him on Facebook here just a minute ago.
Yeah, yeah. You said you saw some of the vinyl off already, right?
Yeah, yeah. I've seen it.
Yeah, yeah. We've had a great vinyl. We've had a great vinyl campaign all year. So what happened was, just to go into that for a second, we had a you know, our first two releases.
Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.